interesting talk, and I really have to put some of these things together to come out with this thing. What can be the top 10 mistakes? And this is all through our experience which we have learned. Let's go through one by one with one or two prototype examples of this thing. So I think you will enjoy this talk. The reason is that because these are all through their real life experiences. Mistake number one, not following a proper approach, being very haphazard in our approach. So I think if you try to take any shortcuts, what Dr. Lim was alluding this morning, following a very systematic approach is so critical. Here we have seen this. We need to follow a very systemic checklist. You can prepare your own checklist what you need to follow, but it is very important. It does not matter how senior you are in experience, you have to still go through the checklist. What I ask in my practice is there anything wrong? Is there something going on wrong? And the patient says, main thing, this is a skin thing, why should I tell my doctor? This is a joint thing, why should I tell? I typically ask them, is there anything going on wrong in your skin, joints, lungs, hearing, anything which you can share with me? Sometimes they may not feel very comfortable, but you have to get them to ask. You have to ask them and then accordingly examine. What we are trying to come out with this is clinical features, look at the symptoms, hear the symptoms, look at the signs, assess the degree of the uveitis, then find out whether you are dealing with the heat, infectious, non-infectious, coming to a morphological diagnosis. So I think this is the first step. What we need to do is to get to a morphological diagnosis, and once you get to the morphological diagnosis, then the thing comes to its etiological diagnosis. So this is each and every one of us have to follow this protocol if you really want to hit the thing. This is a very simple chart which I just prepared for you. Is how do you go step by step before reaching to a diagnosis. So if you follow this algorithm, I think 90% of the time you will be successful, but some of the time you may have to revisit. What I have not put is, sometimes you may have to revisit here. So this is a case with some blur vision with insidious onset, but has some reddish vision on the tip of the nose. A granulomatous kind of uveitis which we all know. Patient was given steroid, some of the things which are happening in the angle, bronchoscopy was done, and the diagnosis of granulomatous uveitis was made. TB sarcoidosis viral. Now going back to examination with specific objective to look at viral, viral wise nothing was there, but what was happening with the nasal rest? So this is what is happening on the nose. How do you trace it to help you with the diagnosis? You find out if the patient is having any related to TB, you went into the examination and asked about the history. You got a tuberculin test which is positive. If negative, if it is positive, it suggests TB. If it is negative, probably sarcoidosis. You think about chest x-ray. So this is the plan which is going on in your mind. And with that plan, you go for the investigation. Okay? And then you start the treatment. You get for the investigation. And accordingly, you modify your treatment. The skin test was negative, which is good. PPD or MENTU test or whatever you call it as. Chest x-ray, which does not give us much. But in this case, we got something. Bilateral, hilar, and right bilateral. Now, what is this which was happening? We thought this can be a lupus pernia which is involving the tip of the nose, such as sarcoidosis. A biopsy was done, and biopsy did show features of non-caseating necrosis, getting as a confirmatory diagnosis. So this is a very simple case to walk through of how a simple clinical test can help you, okay, to get into the proper diagnosis. So this was a case of sarcoid with typical nose, the nose involvement, and we got into this with a granulomatous test. This is just an example, a systematic approach. Question. In this case, I missed this lesion. And I almost would have failed this thing. I looked at the eye, I was very excited, I got the diagnosis, 25-year-old male, but I forget to look at the palms and all. And I sent to infectious, luckily I sent to infectious disease on a Thursday evening. Friday, the infectious disease called me to say they got something up and they want to take over the patient. Why they want to take over the patient? This was, all of us, we should have an attachment with the infectious disease. This was a syphilis rash, and then they diagnosed as some kind of syphilis going on. Okay. And we got some other bug, but the one of the diagnosis was syphilis here, but there was additional thing which was going on. But the diagnosis here turned out to be syphilis. And we have seen multiple patients having some kind of skin thing. And here again, the way, manner which we went with the approach was a very haphazard. We did not went for a good systemic history and a systemic examination. We almost failed in our diagnosis. The pearl number one, systematic approach will save time, efforts, money, and possibly avoid frustration. I think we have seen this case already. I have run through that. To mistake non-UVA-based entity for UVA-based, and that is where I said a good examination will be crucial. I have already covered this in the previous talk, and we'll probably skip this, and we'll go to the MCQ number 2. What do you think it is? Where you say mistake. These are all the mistakes which we have done. What is this? Which may be thinking as a UVA desire. So here the message is non-UVA entity as UVA. Anyone? Or all of you are feeling hungry?
No.
Yeah? Someone should come out from the back. And then sitting quiet. Any diagnosis? This was consider masquerade, and we got the diagnosis of codes stages here. This was a codes manifesting as UVA. Okay, this is what Dr. Lim said in a previous talk, incomplete examination. I think this is one thing which we have to be very careful, and in one particular case, this is going to be a very important case which I will show it to you, and this is a case managed by myself. A 26-year-old Chinese male presented with the floaters on Thursday of right side, headache, day minus 3, 3 days before presentation, floaters followed by dulling of the vision, pain on eye movement, saw an eye specialist, was diagnosed with papilloma. Everything fits well into the papilloma, perfect. Was referred to a higher center for further treatment. Our neurologist saw, started on IV prednisone. Looking at this, are you all happy? What is missing? What is missing here? Is it complete? Is it, am I, as an ophthalmologist, am I justified in studying patient on IV prednisone? Till now, I don't know whether eye specialist has seen or not. What is missing? What do anyone want to know? Okay? The patient was admitted under neurology, diagnosed as right eye optic neuritis, and with direct ophthalmoscopy. Mark my point, direct ophthalmoscopy, and commenced from IV methylprednisolone. After 1 day, was referred to the eye. Okay? This is our typical eye thing which we record in our hospital setting. Now what is, anyone can pick up anything? This is little bit bigger than the direct ophthalmoscopy, 45 degree, yeah? Someone is pointing out, something happening temporally here. Okay, something is happening here. Okay, let's get into that. Okay, here we have got, so this is mistake number 3, incomplete examination of the retina before you commence any of the therapy. So there was a patch of retinitis which was sitting there, which was missed and which was possibly leading to optic neuritis. Then we went into the entire history, and this is where you start going into the history. And patient was already completed IVNP, we cannot do that, but we then started, asked them to taper the steroids, and it was, by the time it was referred, we diagnosed as a chorioretinitis with vasculitis. Top of my diagnosis was viral, TB, syphilis, and I sent the blood and ECTAP for everything. Okay, this is the FA. I got syphilis positive, single test positive. I was saying, good. I got my diagnosis RPR negative, I was happy. I got my diagnosis, started on IV penicillin. But mistake number 4, within the same case, we'll see 3 mistakes. How? That was a red herring. And I saw on Friday, Thursday, Friday, and then thought, okay, things are good. Let's not see for next 2 days. But after third day, this patient has to be kept under constant observation. The picture changed. Follow-up and monitoring. So this brings us to mistake number 4. Essential to have very close monitoring in patients with uveitis, especially those with possible infectious uveitis. So here, the picture evolved. Initially, it was responding, but after that, you can see there are multiple patches which are happening all over the retina, which was not there in earlier thing. So this was patient on penicillin therapy. Usually, after the penicillin therapy, they respond very well, but this is a day 5 after that. How this person? Anyone, any diagnosis? I revised my diagnosis. Then I said, no, this is not happening. This is probably we are treating with an ARN or a PORN. No vitritis, that's what I put my money on PORN, and we started looking for a vitreous step. And we went for a vitreous step. Vitreous step came out to be positive for HSV, which was more of ARN. So this was an ARN case with not much of vitritis in that, but definitely the retinal necrosis which was happening. And we started the patient on the treatment. The patient started improving, foscarnet was given, Velacetrovir was given, everything which was discussed in the previous lecture was given. Patient improved, quite good, very good, everything was going on. mistake number 5. In the same case, not stopping. What happened? Patient improved, no vitritis almost. Should I have done the laser? Someone asked me in the morning.
Should I have done the laser?
Maybe yes. I don't know. I am still suspecting. Because what happened next? Patient developed. Getting the timing right, appropriate intervention at right time, and speech in time can save mind. Okay, prophylactic laser perhaps, maybe. This is a plus minus question, but here you start suspecting whether you should have done, because patient after few days, and I given a longer follow up here again. 1 week follow up, and then this is after with my 15 years of experience of uveitis. This is the mistake that I am committing here. Okay, a possible barrage laser could have probably saved, but had a detachment, then a surgery. Now no more mistakes, enough for one decided. Okay, so don't get any more surprises. So this is a flow chart which will show how the patient has an ups and down course. Finally, he's doing good and doing well, but we learn. So this was a good learning case for me and taught me a few lessons here. And never to take any patient with uveitis lightly. What is one thing, one picture missing here? A patient with hypopyon uveitis, I got HLA-B27 positive. Yay, got the diagnosis. Perfect. Started on steroid, responded. Perfect. But what is one thing missing here? Initially, the pupil was like this, pupil got dilated nicely with atropine and all. Everything very good. What is one thing one should ask from the previous case? Fundus. Patient had an occlusive retinal vasculitis. Occlusive. Had a TVT spot positive, now doing very, very well with anti vascular therapy. Again, all these cases you have to see the retina, have to do a complete examination. There is no shortcuts in uveitis, I should say that. Okay, what are the take home messages here? A dilated fundus examination, ruling out the infective cause, monitoring close follow-up, appropriate intervention at the right time are the very important messages learned from one case itself. So these are the few messages which are learned from one case. Okay. Let's go to the next mistake. So these are the few mistakes which you have done. Not to think outside the box. Out of the box or outside the box. Yeah. A 14-year-old male child and decreasing the vision for 3 months had some seizure disorder. Okay? And here you got a very funny looking retina with the retinal hemorrhages and all. And what is happening here? A detachment, macular edema, you do an FFA. There is definitely a blocked fluorescent, delay in the filling, and you can see there are some areas of blocked fluorescence here, and there is a rapid worsening within 3 days. It's worsening, the retinal edema is worsening here. But we are not giving attention to what's happening systemically. There is a seizure disorder, poor school performance, no history of abnormal behavior, abnormal, no history of fever associated with the retinal past. What are the thoughts? Went for an MRI, MRI showed a flare. And that is where you do a CSF tap and patient diagnosed to have subacute sclerosing panencephalitis. Okay, this is again a very rare diagnosis, but in a child, you have to think outside the box. So I'm not saying the diagnosis will come to you. You have to think laterally. Okay, you have to think something which is not happening, something unusual. That is how you come to a diagnosis of unusual thing. Be very Sherlock Holmes kind of thing. Something who is not a suspect, prime suspect, you start suspecting those things. So this is how the uveitis can get very interesting. Even though we don't have money. Okay? So this is the patient then responded eventually. Okay, think outside the box in approaching a patient with uveitis. So this is the important message. Now spending some time. I think this is again mistake number 7. Spending more time with a patient with a uveitis. We try to rush through cataracts, 5 minutes, femtosecond, few minutes, everything in few minutes. It's the time, how fast you can do an interview. But uveitis, unfortunately, no. You have to pay attention, each and everything. And here again, I missed out. This is again my case. A patient with a CMV retinitis in the superior quadrant. I was giving him injection very nicely, happy, lesion getting resolved. And after 11th injection, patient came to me. With this, I am thinking what this can be. Now, there were some tests which were done in the patient, because I saw the patient first time, I did everything. But there was one test I did not saw 10 weeks before. And then I told my registrar, okay, let's think and do some tests next day. Next day he said, you have already done that test 2-3 months before. I said, oh, what is that positive? He said, yes. What was that test? That test was syphilis. So this was a syphilis. So this is called a syphilitic plaquoid chorioretinopathy. The patient had positive syphilis. I ignored that test and I went ahead with my CMV retinitis treatment. And I was happy that patient was responding. The patient had syphilis titer down, which was positive but was not red. It was not flagged up. And no attention was paid to the positive syphilis titer. And that is where the diagnosis got missed. And then the reason after the syphilis, this was the patient I was seeing on doxycycline, he had allergic penicillin. He improved. He is now completely normal. So basically, to check all the investigations, what you have, to check the medications with the patient and to consult the patients about that. About the medication, I will share a very common example which I still remember from my days in India. I prescribed patient azithromycin or toxoplasma. So this patient came back with treatment of azathioprine. Azathioprine, you know what it is, and azithromycin. It's the same word. You have to check in our local context, you have to check what patient is taking, azithromycin or azathioprine. This is very, very important. Okay? Again, a very unfortunate case, point number 8. So, picture in the right eye was the similar picture in the left eye. I don't have any injection before the intervention, but this was taken after. Both right and left eye had a post intravitreal injection of N-cyclodine. I was at IOIS meeting last year, San Francisco, and when this patient was seen and was given injection for something which was looking in the right eye, they diagnosed as a CMV retinitis and they had given injection. So this is where I was saying zone 2 and zone 3, do not need to rush, get an expert opinion if you are not confident. Unfortunately, the patient lost the vision in the left eye after the intravitreal N-cyclodine injection. There was nothing in the macular. Patient vision was 6x. So this is how a patient became after the injection. Okay? So there was no CMV retinitis, no indications for the injection. It was given for HIV retinopathy. There was just an HIV macroangiopathy. Patient got the injection and lost the vision. So be confident before administering intravitreal therapy, whether you talk about Ozurdex, are you confident? Whether you talk about posterior subtenon, are you confident enough? Whether you talk about any invasive test, are you confident enough? I think that is where I start doubting myself. Am I confident enough? Because administering and the technical skills anyone can do. But your value as a physician, once you go out of this room, is getting the things right for that patient. Is it something required or you need an extra help, an extra opinion? Do not get your ego on the way before taking an extra help. Always be. There are so many. So nowadays we are still managing a patient on WhatsApp. I think there are so many technologies available, email, WhatsApp, this thing and all. You can be in constant touch with your patient. Okay, so this is again one of the things which we have stressed again and again, of getting a working diagnosis. So I think in UPAD is always like to put a word working diagnosis. You don't have any confirmed diagnosis like cataract. So here again, we had a diagnosis of this patient which is thought diffuse vascular leakage, thought of a diagnosis of TB uveitis, started the patient on anti-TB drugs and all, and eventually we made a diagnosis of viral retinitis, but eventually the things were getting bad, and then you change the diagnosis to lymphoma after a chorioretinal biopsy and lymphoid biopsy. How a diagnosis can change? A diagnosis which was in your records, viral retinitis, then become a TB uveitis, and then can eventually become a lymphoma. This is how the things can keep on changing in a setting of a uveitis. So don't be afraid, don't be shy in changing your diagnosis. Be very flexible. Okay? What we got here are some of the things. Important, pay attention to the subtle clues. Look at the patient and not the labs. This is very important. We are not treating an eye here. We are treating a person, a complete thing. A lot of time we forget. But think this is a patient sitting in front of you. It's just not the eye, not your labs thing. I think this is again a very important. Okay. This is a last message, but there are, I know, many more messages, but this is what we are trying to articulate here, putting into all the boxes. Infectious etiology with non-infectious. So this was something, an infective kind of thing. Looks like infective, but was treated as a non-infective, some mass kind of thing. And all the investigations were done. Axillary lymph node were palpable and mobile. ESR was high. Skin test was negative. TB gold test was negative. Thought it's effective. PET scan was done, enhancing system lesion, omentary deposits, CA was done, underwent FNAC guided biopsy from the adnexal mass, shows areas of ages necrosis. You see this patient, TBT spot negative, MEN2 negative, and still showing a fizzling necrosis, and then you got your AFB staining, which is positive for AFB. So I think this is how things can be misleading. We are thinking it's a metastasis because of all the thing, and but when you really went into histopathology will never lie to you. And then you got the diagnosis, which was changed. So basically, you can have all these things, a high index of suspicion for infectious etiology. And to, just to sum up, I think these are the last three slides to sum up. Getting a systematic approach, consider masquerade, a full dilated examination, rule out infective causes, regular monitoring and a very close follow-up, appropriate intervention at the right time. Think outside the box, check all the investigations you have, check all the medications patient have. To counsel the patient very, very well, be confident before administering invasive therapy. Don't hesitate to seek opinion, second opinion. Keep your ego aside. Important to pay attention to certain clues. Listen to each and everything what our patient or EVAD is saying. Look at the patient and not labs. And keep high index of suspicion for infectious etiology. At this point, I've repeated twice, high index of suspicion for infectious etiology. Okay? So these are some of the points for this revision.
Thank you very much. Before lunch, we would like to have a quick photograph with some of our faculty today. So we're just going to organize a stage, and I'll need, if you don't mind, all of you to come up on stage. We'll take a quick photograph, and then we have a buffet lunch for you downstairs.